right, well, here we go. Are you ready? Grab your Bibles and do me a favor, stand up as we read God's word together. And we're going to make sure that you can see. We're going to read this. I couldn't figure out how to start, so this is how we're going to start today, okay? So here we go. Revelation chapter 1. If you didn't bring your Bible, it's fine. It'll be on the screen for you. Here we go. Revelation 1, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it. For the time is near. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace and peace. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever. Amen. Behold, he is coming in the clouds, and every eye will see him, and those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail upon account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. And I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna and to Pergamum and to Thyatira and to Sardis and to Philadelphia and to Laodicea. And then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and I turned and on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed in a long robe, and with a gold sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and his feet were like burnished bronze refined in a furnace. And his voice was like a roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet, though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, these things that you have seen, those that are to take place after this. As for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. This is God's word for God's people. Go ahead and grab your seat. Are you ready? Here's what's crazy. When you open your Bible to the last book of the Bible, you have one of two options. Some of you are freaking out right now. When I said we're starting a series on Revelation, I was talking to Kale this week, and she was like, I'm kind of freaking out right now. And you're freaking out because you saw the Left Behind movies. And if Kurt Cameron gets left behind, we're all up a creek without a paddle. And some of you are like, I don't know. And then they came out with another Left Behind, and Nick Cage got left behind, which is totally explainable when Nicolas Cage gets left behind. So I don't know where we're going to go with all this. But when you get a book filled with 666 and 144,000, and what is that? And you got these scrolls, and we don't have scrolls today. And you've got all these animals with weird heads and multiple heads and dragons and beasts and this Antichrist. And people are like, I'm just going to skip that one. And I'll just go to the maps in the back of my Bible, and we'll camp out there for a while. And see, what we do is we really zero in on the what is all that? We zero in on when is all that going to happen? And then we say, okay, well, where am I going to be when all that happens? And the fact of the matter is that rather than doing spiritual math and figuring out what all those numbers are and figuring out when the win is and how it all is going to go down, my encouragement for you today is not to focus on all those things. You got to focus on the who of Revelation. And the who of Revelation is a great king, and his name is Jesus. And this book should not bring up fear in your heart. This book should give you comfort and courage, because this is the consummation of all things. And yes, what you might experience now might come to an end, but what you're going to experience if you're in Christ is just the beginning. And so my goal for us today, and really, honestly, the whole series, but specifically today, is to catch a vision of Jesus and keep it. That's what I want you to see with what John experiences today, is to catch a vision of Jesus and keep that vision at the forefront, because when you do that, you, along with thousands of other believers, for two millennia, can stand in the face of trouble, stand in the face of trial, and stand in the season of persecution and pressure and darkness. Not with fear, but with great courage. Because you see the end. And the end is a person. And it is Jesus Christ. So where do we start today? Really where we start is with, number one, the revelation. It's the best place to start. Verse one, we see this, and we see it right out of the gate. It says, the revelation of Jesus Christ. The revelation of Jesus Christ. Well, so first let's ask the simple question, what in the world is a revelation? It's the Greek word apokalypsis, which sounds like what? Apocalypse. In your mind, think of this. Think of all those dystopian novels of the mid-2000s. Think of all those movies like The Hunger Games. How does it all end? Everybody's fascinated with what is it like in the future? That's what apocalyptic literature is. It's, I want to know what is out there in the future. And that word, revelation, means apocalypse, apocalyptic, and it really just means a revealing, an unveiling. It is somebody unpacking something for you that you don't know about, and they're revealing that to you, and then you're like, oh my gosh, that's actually pretty incredible. Think of it like a birthday gift. The person who gives you the birthday gift wraps that whole thing up and then hands it to you, and you're jacked, you're excited. I got this gift. But you don't even know what's on the inside until what? Until you open it, and then once it is revealed what it is, you're like, dude, that's awesome. But the giver knew the whole time how awesome that gift really was. That's the book of Revelation in a nutshell. We're going to unravel this as best as we can, and we're going to literally unpack this gift, and God already knows how solid it is. God already knows how awesome it is for us and how relevant it is to our lives. We just got to do the job of unpacking it and enjoying this great gift of this book, Revelation. So, who's presenting the book? Whose revelation is this? If you've got a Bible like mine, it says the revelation of John up there at the top. That's actually wrong. It's not the revelation of John. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. It says it in verse 1. Doesn't it say it right there? Verse 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ. John's just jotting it down. That's all he's doing. He's writing it down. So this has really less to do with John and more to do with God. And God is bringing this revelation through Jesus Christ. And then really the next logical question is, why in the world did he do this? Why did God feel like he needed to give this revelation? Well, there's a purpose of this revelation. Look at verse 1. It says, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the things that must soon take place. The purpose of this revelation is that phrase, to show. It means to explain. What God is doing through Jesus, and John is writing down, is he's saying, hey, there's some stuff out there in your future, in front of you, on the freeway of your life and the freeway of history, that you don't know what's out there yet. You don't know what's around the left turn. You don't know what's around the right turn. Totally fine. That's okay. This book, this revelation, is going to give you these signs on the side of that freeway that tell you what's about to come next. And I'm going to explain to you what that is. That's what Jesus is doing for John. The second purpose is for them to get this level of expectation. So he's going to explain what's about to happen. He's going to show them what's going to happen. And then they've got to develop this internal, monitor in their heart that's like in the hospital. Beep, 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 like that, like the heart monitor. You need to develop this monitor in your heart that reads the times and then allows you to live with a level of expectation. It's that word soon. You should circle that in your Bible. Soon. Now, if there's anybody in this room that has any level of skepticism, this is where you start going, yeah, I don't think I can believe this whole thing. Wasn't this book written a long time ago and you're saying that the end of all things and Jesus Christ returning is going to happen soon? Like, how can that happen soon? Like, this was written a long time ago. Correct. Like in 90 AD. It was written a long time ago. The problem with our definition of soon is, what do we think of? This is an opportunity for you to include yourself in the sermon. Awesome for you. What do you think of when you think of the word soon? Huh? Tomorrow? Somebody else said something else. What? In 10 minutes. Immediate. Like when we read the word soon, we go, oh, okay, so he's going to show his servant the things that must take place soon. Like when Pastor Aaron finishes his sermon, which will not be soon. Soon. What we think immediate, but do you know what he means when he writes soon? He doesn't think immediate, he doesn't think 10 minutes, doesn't think right now, the next very second. He thinks imminent. Imminent means sure thing. It will be happening. You see, the things that are going to be laid out through the book of Revelation and what's going to be laid out to these seven churches, this is imminent. It's happening. It's not haphazard. It's not like God's up in heaven and he's like just taking a nap and he's forgotten what's happened to the world. It's not like God just looks at the world and is like, oh man, I never saw that. That's crazy. I didn't know that was going to happen. This is actually under divine decree. What's happening is intentional. What is going to happen within the contents of this book is literally by sovereign decree of God, and it is not haphazard in any way. Which brings me to the process of the revelation. How does it all unfold? It goes right here. At the end of verse 7, we haven't got there yet, it says, he made it known. So God gave him this message to show it to the servants, the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angels to his servant, John, who bore witness, verse 2, to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. So here are the steps. God in heaven then gives the message, and notice the next place it goes to. He gives the message to Jesus. Jesus gives the message to the angels. Then the angels give the message to John, and then John gives the message to the seven churches of Revelation. There's a process that's beginning to unfold in unloading this revelation. He says that it's made known. Verse 1, circle that phrase in your Bible, made known. It's the word, if you like to write in your Bible, just write signal. It's a signal. It's a sign. It's a signal. And there are going to be things that you're going to need to be looking for about how the future will unfold. Now, this is where it gets a little hokey, okay? Got to be real with you. Because that word or that phrase made known brings the idea of figurative representation. What does that mean? Here's what it means. The book of Revelation is filled with symbolism. If you were to take apocalyptic literature in the first century and just start stacking up books of apocalyptic literature on a table in an ancient library, you could literally stack up the book of Revelation next to all other apocalyptic literature because it feels the same. If you were to read those, you would see in other religions, even in other just natural writings, you would see weird beasts, weird animals, and a ton of symbolism, a ton of numbers, and a ton of imagery. So this book fits in with first century apocalyptic literature, and it's got a ton of representation and symbolism. And so what we have to understand is that it's going to give, track with me here, future history, and there are some things that are absolutely real that aren't symbols. These seven churches are historical sites that you could go to and see. You can't see the physical structure, but you can go to these cities. You can see them. There are certain things in history that actually happened that are documented. We're going to talk about some of that this morning that you're going to see. But it also There are some real things. There's very real persecution coming. There's very real trials and significant struggles within these seven churches that are factual, data-driven. You can see it in history. But it also unfolds some future history that we don't quite know what all of it means. And you can get lost in that. That's why people get into numerology and or numerology, and they start to figure out all these dates and times. And let me tell you, if you found somebody who said, "I know when Jesus is coming," that'd be a shock to Jesus, because he doesn't even know when he's coming. Only the Father knows. Only the Father knows. And so it's not our job, Acts 1 tells us, it's not our job to figure out when that time is. It's not our job to do that. And so we don't want to get lost in all this imagery, this figurative representation. Definitely real things that are going to happen, but there's a lot of symbolism here. Notice verse 2, who is a part of this process as well? It's the servant, which is John the Apostle. There's some debate, by the way. I'm going to save you time. There's some debate on who this John is. I don't believe there's debate. As much as I can research this week, I think it's John the Apostle. Meaning, who is that? James and John, sons of thunder, sons of Zebedee, that guy. That's who it is. Now, at this point, he is now super old, and he's writing this account, so I believe it's John the Apostle. I want you to notice in verse 3 the promise. Now, when you dive into the book of Revelation, there's a promise that you get. Everybody up for a promise today? Like, this is the good news. I mean, there's a lot of good news, believe it or not. So no reason to freak out, lots of courage, lots of comfort, but here's some really good news. For those of us that open this book, look at what it says, and we read it. It says, blessed. There are 12 Beatitudes in the book of Revelation. Did you know that? Of course you didn't know that. You didn't look at it this week like I did, okay? It's fine. There are 12. I didn't know it either until I read it. And I was like, there are 12 of these. We're not going to study all of them. We get one of them. But here it is. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear. What does that mean? What it means is in the first century, not everybody read. Not everybody is, like, most of you are intelligent people, and you can read. And you can tell, those are words on a page, words on a screen. I know what that says. But what he's saying is that when somebody would get up and read this out loud, this book, to a congregation, not everybody could read. And so then the person who read and can read and the person who hears, they're blessed equally. And notice the second little attachment here. And who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. He's saying there is blessing for those of us right now that are engaging in this. And for those of us that are enraptured with the message of the book of Revelation, and your heart is captured by it, and you actually read it and you heed it, your life is shaped by what you're engaging, you are literally walking in the blessing and in the favor of God. Who's up for that today? I'm up for that. I want that. I want that because so much about what's in the future is doomsday. I mean, I don't want to fight to stay alive like Katniss Everdeen. I'm not in for that. I'm not for that. So I've got to look forward with hope, and the hope is found right there. And we live in light of forever, in light that the end is imminent, and not end in a bad way, but that the end is the person, Jesus Christ, and we see him. And we live with that kind of intentionality every single day. So that's the revelation. Number 2, the proclamation. You didn't even think I could move that fast, did you? The proclamation. Notice who he's writing to. So Revelation is a part of apocalyptic literature. It's really annoying, to be honest with you, because you got this apocalyptic, like, symbolism, numbers, all this really fun stuff that you just get to read, and it feels like, oh my gosh, this is such great detail. And then it kind of switches a little bit, and it gets a little organized. Most of Revelation is unorganized. Facts, okay? You just are. The part we're studying, praise God, is the most organized part in the whole book. These seven churches. After you get past these seven churches, you're like, I have no clue what's happening next. That's okay. It's totally fine. And so we get this moment now where there's some organization, and now it turns to this letter format. So he's writing, notice the recipients are John, verse 4, to the seven churches that are in Asia. This is now a letter that will be read. This is crazy. Well, what happens if somebody, let me just cap. Take a little sidebar here. What happens if somebody goes to your mailbox, opens your mail, and reads your mail? Is that legal? No, they go to jail. Well, in the first century, everybody got to read everybody's mail. right here, they're going to take this letter to these seven churches, and you're going to get to read. Thyatira is going to go, Ephesus, woo! They're going to go, man, Laodicea, they are cray-cray. All these kind of things. They're going to get to read that. Why? Because there's a universal message in all of it that we're prone to. And so now it turns to a letter. John's already told him who he was. There's no reason to identify, oh, I'm John, and here's my credentials. Apparently, after the second time of mentioning, hey, it's me, John, your brother, he's going to say it again. It's this idea that they know him. These seven churches, they're aware of who John is and that he has, at some level, some influence and some leadership over their lives. So you can trust me is what he's saying. And he writes to these seven churches. Who are they? Well, we already read it, but it's let me show you on this map really quickly these seven churches. And we start on the bottom left, and we'll just kind of work our way in a circular clockwise fashion to get your mind wrapped around where this is in the world, because this doesn't do it. Let me show you a map of what it looks like in the world today. Hotly contested real estate. Turkey is hotly, it's intense. Super intense area of the world. And that's where we're studying today in this particular geographical location. You can go see this to this very day. But why these seven? I wrestled with that a lot this week. Why just these seven? Why are we going to these particular seven? Were there other influential churches? Of course there were. Yes, there were churches all over. Churches all over the Middle East, Northern Africa. They were everywhere. Why these seven? Well, there's a lot of debate about these seven. One, it's just seven is the number of completion, and so it's just arbitrarily, hey, this is a complete picture of history. Others would say that these seven churches are talked about because of emperor worship, which I kind of lean towards as well. Maybe these seven churches are a picture of the stages of church history. So you got Ephesus, that's a particular age in church history. Then you got the second age in church history, and you got these seven ages of church history. I don't know if that's true or not. It feels kind of true, and we'll study that as we go through these next several weeks. If you didn't catch it, this is an overview Sunday, by the way, just so you know. We're not going to jump into all seven of these churches because we'd be here maybe till Jesus comes back. We could be right now or now. But most likely, these churches were chosen because of the particular... Paul, go back to that map, the first one. Because of their particular location on the Roman postal routes. So these were major hubs in the Roman Empire, in Turkey, in Asia. And so if they go to these places, they can disseminate this information faster. And there's a high populace of people, lots of wealth concentrated in these particular areas, and major hubs and communication portals that would get out throughout the region. Now, I want to get your mind wrapped around the context of why probably these seven churches were chosen. You got to go broader context here. So about, what is it, maybe a few decades after Jesus died on the cross and rose, there was an emperor named Nero. And Nero hated Roman emperor hated Christians. Now, to start, what he did was he lumped Christians and Jews together. They're part of one group of people. And Judaism was a legal religion that was allowed by the state, Rome, for people to worship because they never saw them as a threat. Judaism wasn't a threat to them. And so they just lumped these Christians for a few decades in as a same group. Well, Nero saw that that's not true. They're actually completely different, which is true. They're completely different religions. And the Christians are a threat. The Jews really aren't a threat. And so Nero found ways throughout his reign to literally unleash evil onto the Christians. One time in particular, it was July, what is it, 17th? I think it was July 17th in 64 AD, July 19th, 64 AD, there was a huge Roman fire. I got a picture for you so you can take a look at it. There was it's a painting, not a picture, obviously. Come on, they didn't have cell phones. We weren't snapping a quick pic here. But this was a huge fire in Rome. And they really didn't know who started the fire, but Nero saw it as an opportunity. Ha ha! I can blame the Christians, which then now legally gives me an opportunity to come after them with even more force. So then he starts impaling them. He starts burning them alive. He starts doing everything he can to unleash torture on the Christians because he hated their message and hated them as people. Fast forward 30 years to Domitian. Domitian is a Roman empire, emperor. And throughout Rome, their empire, they had these moments of intense emperor worship and moments where there was less emperor worship. But Domitian comes back and says, yeah, we're redoing that thing. State-sanctioned religion. That's what you got to think about. State-sanctioned religion. It's interesting, two cities of the seven where these churches are, they had built emperor temples, emperor churches, where you would go in and you would worship the emperor, you would adore the emperor, you would give your money to the emperor, you would do what we're doing now, but not to God, but to who? The Roman emperor, which they believed they were God. Here's the problem. Rome, to these seven churches, said, here's the rule. Here's the mandate. Worship the emperor. The state comes in and tells them what they need to worship. The state comes in and says, this is how it's got to look. This is how it's got to happen. This is how things roll out. You have to worship the emperor. Well, then you could tell that would pose a problem for the believer, because the believer says there is no one else but God. It is God and God alone. It is Yahweh. It is Jesus, the person of Jesus. He is the face of God on the earth. We have the power of the Spirit. We are only worshiping God. There is none other. You could see how that would pose a problem for these first century Christians. Here's what happened. As we study these seven churches, we're going to learn that the state comes in and says, this is how it's got to look. The Christians inside are going, ah, man, I don't like that. So then they back up. Some in the church said, no, I think we should do that. Inside the church, I think we should go ahead and worship the emperor and do it the way the state says to do it. Well, what would that do in their context? Oh my gosh, it would have an eruption of disunity, an eruption of discord, an eruption of just unbelievable problems in their context, because they can't worship the state and worship God. It's one or the other, not both. God is either your God or Rome is your God. And it doesn't work that way, but some of these Christians on the inside are like, oh my gosh, no. And then John, through Jesus, through John, calls those Christians, air quotes, inside the church who want to do it the way that Rome tells them to do it. He says that they are from the synagogue of Satan. That they are sent by Satan himself as his messengers to disrupt what God is doing in the church. That is some strong language. So there was tension and persecution and pressure and trials and struggle in the church and outside the church, because you can only imagine what Rome saw. Oh, we got a divided body. Now let's just capitalize on all this division and take them out. I don't know if that sounds familiar to you or not. Maybe that's why the seven churches are there. Because there's a universal message to the church of Jesus Christ in every generation, to catch a vision of Jesus and keep it at all costs and stand with bold courage in the face of whatever emperor tells you what to do. That was a good spot for an amen. So through this proclamation, he's obviously given us some great detail to these recipients, and now we got a greater context, but there's also a reminder. Notice this reminder. We all need a reminder of this. Verse 4, second part of verse 4, it says, grace to you and peace. Who doesn't need a little bit of that in their life? Man, when you're facing an intense moment, a dark season, when the church at large feels like we're fighting a Goliath, it feels like we're behind the eight ball. It's the fourth quarter, fourth down, 20 yards, game on the line, we got to go for it. Feels like that sometimes. And the reminder is, ha, 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 grace to you in that. Don't freak out. There's peace to you in that. Notice where it comes from. Notice where this, it says it comes from him who is and who was and who is to come. Who is that? That should reek of Exodus. It is the great I am. It is God Almighty. He's saying this peace flows from the fountain of God's character to his family. Grace and peace are yours. You can't have his peace if you don't have his grace, found in his son, Jesus, by the way. And it's flowing from God to you and to me. Notice who else it's coming from. And from the seven spirits who are before his throne. Now don't get weird on me. All this is talking about is the full representation. Seven means complete. Full representation of the power of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. Can you see where John's going already? You've got God giving you this peace by the power of the Holy Spirit through who? Who's next? Just read it in there. What's the next verse? What does it say? Don't leave me up here by myself. I'll start over right now. Jesus Christ. Do you see right there the Trinitarian view of God, the Godhead, what makes God God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, that grace that is available only to the believer in this tough and dark time. The only thing that's going to get you through it is the grace of God and his peace that will surpass all human understanding. You've got the Godhead at your access to give you courage and boldness when you're facing an unknown future. That is unbelievable. Notice what Robert Mounts says. Love this. He says, the threefold title is intended to encourage and sustain believers about to enter a time of severe persecution for their faith in Jesus. Come on. To know that you've got God, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus, God, at your right side, left side, back side, and front side, supporting you, encouraging you, and empowering you, that enables me to stand against anything. That's why I feel so confident today, because I've encountered Jesus in Revelation 1, and I have nothing to fear because of that. And I just want to give the reminder that, yes, this is to the seven churches. You know that? Like, it's written to those churches in Asia. It can't mean what it never meant to them. So they obviously got courage from the Trinity. They got boldness knowing that God is in their corner. But I don't want you to miss this. You're his church too. You are his church too. If you profess faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you've been secured by the shed blood of Christ. Your faith gives you access to the Father because of what Jesus has done for you. And you're a part of the body of Christ too. Notice what he says in verse 5. He says, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings on earth. He is above all things, faithful and true. To him, that one, Jesus, who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us a kingdom. Guess what that is? He has made us a collection of believers. He has corporately united us as a kingdom, as a church, as a family. God's building his church. It's us. But then he turns it individually, and he says, but he's made you a priest too. You're an individual, but you're brought together to be a part of something bigger than yourselves. A priest to his God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Right now, God loves you. And right now, God has saved you by what we just celebrated last Sunday, by the life, death, and the resurrection of Jesus. And he's freed you from your sin by his Son, brought you into a kingdom, made you a priest with direct access to him. And when we face our season of struggle and darkness and persecution, we must remember that we are his. We are his. We are his, which means he's coming for you. He's coming for you. You're not hidden to God. He knows right where you are. He knows right where the Summit Church is today. He knows right where every church in America that is filled with genuine followers of Jesus Christ. God knows where his church is, and he's coming for her. That's what he says in the next verse. He says, behold, verse 7. That means, hey, open your eyes. This is John saying, y'all better wake up. You better wake up to the reality that Jesus loves you, he died for you, and he's going to come for you. And he's coming. He's coming with clouds. Clouds is a symbol of God's manifest presence. Hello, pillar of cloud in Exodus. Come on. He's coming with clouds, with the very presence of God. He's bringing God back. He says, every eye will see him. What does every eye will see him mean? Literally, this is not symbolism, by the way. Every eye will actually see him and those who pierced him. Don't think the Romans who pierced him. Think the Jews who denied him. The ones who he came for, the Jews, they said, I'm out. And they will see him and go, oh my gosh. See, the Jews don't believe Jesus is the Messiah. They believe that he was a great political leader and kind of an earth shaker. But when they see him this time, they'll go, whoa, we got it wrong. Whoa, we got it wrong. He's coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, and those who have pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him, because if they haven't repented of their sin and turned to Jesus Christ, that visible seeing of Jesus will be an act of judgment on the earth. It will. Because today is the day of salvation. What do you do about those tribes that haven't heard a faithful witness yet? The Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. They need to hear Romans, the gospel. That's why we have these unreached and unengaged people groups across the world that don't have a faithful witness, don't have a Bible translation that we should engage with. And we are engaged with that as a part of a program called the Cooperative Program through our funding that we send missionaries to those parts of the world where none of us will ever go. And we need language training and Bible translation, all that. You're not going to do that. You got jobs. You're going to do something else. But there are people that's their job, to get to every tribe, every tongue, and every nation. And then John says, even so, amen. You know what that means? Let it be today. Come on. Exclamation point, signature at the end, done. John ends with that unbelievable moment and that proclamation, and Jesus is like, oh, come on, let's go. And this is what he says right here. He interrupts him. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. Jesus uses this intentionally. Alpha and Omega is the Greek alphabet, the first letter and the last letter. I am the beginning and the end of all knowledge. Rome, that's not you, it's me. I'm the one who was, is, and is to come. I am faithful and true and present throughout human history. The Almighty, I am above and through and in all things. What a proclamation. That's who we have. Why would we be fearful? Why would we be fearful when we have the great king who is our leader? Well, thirdly, the commission. You getting some encouragement today? Amen, amen. Well, start with this in the commission, where John was. Verse 9, where was he hanging out? He wasn't like partying, but it is kind of a party town today. Got to be real with you. I'll show you in a second. But verse 9, it says, I, John, your brother and your partner in the tribulation in the kingdom, the patient endurance that are in Jesus. Here's what John's saying. I'm about to tell you how bad it's going to get. But before I tell you how bad it's going to get, I got to tell you it's been bad to me too. I'm a co-laborer in this whole thing with you. I'm not some dude who isn't using what I'm selling. I've been a part of this with you. I'm a brother, fellow believer of Jesus Christ, and I've endured some stuff too. Matter of fact, I'm enduring some stuff right now. So when you're going through a hard time, know, hey, your brother over here in Patmos, he's there with you because he struggled as well. He says he was on the island called Patmos. That's where he was. After faithfully preaching the gospel in Asia, the church grew and the state, domination, wanted to silence him to Patmos. Let me show you Patmos here. This is just a little picture of Patmos is actually on the bottom right side, or your right, my left, over here. And then he's looking, it's 35-ish miles there's a port city outside of Ephesus, and that's kind of the launching pad where he was sent from, and now here, and he hated him. Some people don't believe that Domitian was as persecuting as he was. Y'all, he threw his own niece on an island and banished her because he didn't like what she was doing. I'm pretty sure he was a hateful dude, okay? And here he is, and Church Father Tertullian, you're like, what's a church father? You should read about that. That's pretty awesome. Like, after the apostles, the next great influencers in the body of Christ. Some Asia, some in Africa, many in Northern Africa. The Church Father Tertullian said of John, this is a legend that says that after suffering no hurt from being plunged into burning oil, Domitian sent him to Patmos. Now, we don't know if he was trying to put John in burning oil or not, but we know he put pressure on him. And whatever that looked like, we have no clue. We don't have necessarily record of it. What we have record of is he got deported. And he got deported to Patmos. Now, back then, it wasn't developed. You go to Patmos today, and Greece is capitalized on it, and it's a resort town. Here's a look of what Patmos looks like today. But you want to go see some beautiful beaches. Greece owns it, and they love it that the Christians like to come spend their money there and suntan and get a sunburn on their beaches. You can go there today. It wasn't that for John. It was a place of torment, but also a place of vision. He was punished at Patmos. Why was he punished? Here it is. Simple. He was a Christian. He loved Jesus. He was punished because he loved Jesus. Notice what the text says. He says he was on an island called Patmos, verse 9, on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was going all through Asia preaching the word, telling of the testimony of the power of the resurrected Christ. And they threw me in jail. Let me just get rid of him. If I can just get rid of him, this whole thing can stop. Yeah, you might cut that snake off at the head, but guess what that snake's going to do? It's going to grow another head. Because the church of Jesus Christ cannot be stopped. It cannot be stopped. He was there on account of the testimony of Jesus. And when John tells these churches that he's being persecuted, he's like, I'm in this with you, co-laborer. What's interesting to me is that there's this notion in Christianity that when you get saved, you're saved from all the suffering. How many of you know that that's not true? It's not true. You're not saved from the suffering. You're saved from eternal suffering, amen? But you're not saved from this side of heaven suffering. It's this idea that if I have cancer in my body and I just say I don't, then I'm good. Okay. Tell me how that goes. You want to know every person who says that, how that goes? I mean, these are foot stats, not real stats. My guess is 100% of those people die. Unless there is a divine intervention of a miracle. But just to say, I don't have cancer, doesn't... That's like saying, if you're 40 pounds overweight, I'm not fat. This Taco Bell is a salad. That Taco Bell will send you to Taco Hell if you're not careful. I'm serious. Like, you got to be really careful with this. If the government is funding your lifestyle, you're not rich. Stop saying you are. Go get a job. Work hard. And then if God prospers you, amen. But to say that you're just... when you come to Christ and you're saved, that it's health, wealth, and prosperity is a fallacy. It's not real. It's not real. Do you know what Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:12? This, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. Why? Because predominant culture hates Christians. It used to get you somewhere when you used to move into a town. The first place you would go is the church. I got to go join the first whatever. First Baptist, First Methodist, First Christian, First Presbyterian, First Assembly of God. Whatever the first one was, you're going there. And I'm going to work my way in, become a deacon, become an elder. whatever it might be, I don't care. And you go there, and it used to get you influence. Now, the church isn't at the center of society. It's on the edges of society, no longer as influential as it used to be. And now, being a Christian is going to cost you something. It's no longer seen as an advantage to have you at where you work. Did you know that? It's no longer seen as an advantage to have you as the president of the neighborhood association, because you're going to influence the neighborhood for Christ. That's better, just so you know. It's better than the alternative. You're going to try to proselytize all these people. Correct. That is what we do. Correct. We are trying to convert people to Christianity. That's what we're doing. And the predominant culture wants to squelch that. And the state's going to come in and force our hands at things at times. And your employer and the people you work with. It's no longer an advantage anymore, and if you want to live a godly life, that's the rub that you're going to experience, and you're going to experience that. And some of you are like, I'm not going to. I'm just going to say I'm not going to. You should go live in your basement then and just go watch YouTube and enjoy the rest of your life. DoorDash all your food, get your groceries delivered. But even then, still you in that room, and you still need Jesus. Well, I digress. What did John see? We see this. We're where John was. Notice what John heard. What John heard. Notice that he was unshaken by his circumstances, and he met with God. Verse 10 says that he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. In the Spirit. What does that mean? That phrase, in the Spirit, is the word definitionally means a trance. He was in a trance. This is different. I don't know if you remember this, but in the book of Acts, Peter was hangry on a roof, totally hangry, wanted a lot of food. God, unbeknownst to him, sent a Gentile. You realize that Peter really didn't love that idea. Peter, Jew and Gentile thing, he wasn't about that bridge. So then God gives him, he goes into a trance, hangry trance. Got to be careful when you're hangry. Weird things can happen. And God, by the power of the Spirit, reveals a vision to him in this moment. He was in the Spirit. And this giant white sheet shows up. And all these unclean things show up on that white sheet. And Peter was like, you mean we can have pulled pork now? To which all God's people said, amen, come on. He's like, yeah, you can, but it's not about the food. It's about the people. Gentile at the front door, that's the vision. Go tell them. Same thing happens to the Apostle Paul. It's on a massive, he just got out of jail. Massive ship, huge storm, everybody's freaking out. God gave him a vision, same word, in the Spirit, trance. And in this vision, angel of the Lord shows up and says, all this stuff is gone, but you I'll save, the people. So then he stands up and tells everybody, we're going to be okay, woo, but we're going to have to swim, woo. Grab a rock or a floaty, something. Same thing. He was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and God showed up, and it gripped his heart, and he had a message. You see, it's not just about encouraging you. It's usually coming through you as a messenger to someone else. And that's what we saw in the book of Acts. If you want to jot those down, it's Acts 10:10 and Acts 22:17 for your further study. The truth is, we got to learn this principle, friends, that our circumstances cannot dictate to us our connection with God. So many of us today are distracted, filled with anxiousness, filled with worry. I am convinced, clinical diagnosis or not, that the enemy is doing everything he can to get into your heart and mind to make you worry, fretful, fearful of the future. Period. Because that will incapacitate you so that you don't connect with the source of all things, which is life, which is God. And if he can get you filled with so much worry and, oh my gosh, I can't move, I can't shake, I'm crying in a pool, in the bathroom, in the shower, and I can't move, what am I supposed to do? The enemy has grabbed our hearts and our minds. And the Spirit of God wants to release you from that burden of worry and give you courage. I don't think it's a coincidence that this generation is the most anxious, worried generation. If we can wrap our minds around what God's actually trying to do right now, you could be freed. I think the end is imminent. I think the return is imminent. I think it's nearer than it ever has been. And what if these people, us, who struggle with this, said enough? Enough. Enough. I'm not going to let my circumstances, I'm not going to let what I think and what I feel in the moment dictate my connection with God. Done. God and God alone, period. I don't have time for that. You don't have time not to. What can you say no to say yes to this? Well, I love the attaboys. I love the accolades. No, stop. Because when you see Jesus face to face, he's not going to be like, dude, you were a solid employee. So glad. Don't be a stranger. Look at him face to face every day. Get a vision of Jesus and keep it. Because that gives you courage and nothing else. Nothing else. What John heard was he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Keep going. What did he hear? I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. That's pretty fire, actually. And startling. Thank you. I don't know if it was like a Louis Armstrong blast or, I don't know. That was more of a trombone, but whatever. Super digress, sorry, I gotta hustle. He said, I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, write this down. Write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna. And we read all those already. Send them to the seven churches. So throughout Revelation, there is this eruption of voices. It's Jesus, first of all. But every time the voice is communicated, it's a loud one. Why? To create the sense of gravity. That what you're about to hear, it's coming from the one who has authority. Start there. It has power. Then you better take it seriously. And so what he's saying here is, I got a message for you, and you need to write this thing down because it's not just about you, it's about them. They need to hear this. And 12 times in the book of Revelation, God commissions John to write down what he saw. I think that's pretty important. If I tell my kids something 12 times, somebody's getting a spanking. You spank your kids? Sure do. You should too. If you got to go 12 times, somebody's not listening. Oh, sore subject here? You need to do a parenting series real quick? Kidding. All right. So the commission, where John was, what John heard, and here's the bread and butter, what John saw. What John saw. What did he see? Well, let's see. Verse 12. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me. What in the world? And before he could get there, he turns and he saw seven golden lampstands. Not what I thought I would see. Thought I would see a trumpeter. Who's with me on that? What? So, like candelabras? That's weird. Why is that happening? I know, right? It's Revelation, right? Like pretty soon you're going to be like, and then I saw a 70-headed animal here, okay? There are tattoos on people's foreheads. And a microchip in their hand so they can buy groceries. I'm just kidding. All right. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me. And on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands. So first thing he sees, follow me here. I'm borrowing this from a book called Because the Time is Near. It's a great book. and changed a little bit of the language, but the structure, I'm borrowing the main headings here from them. Jesus empowering his church. First thing he sees in this vision of Jesus is the empowerment of Jesus. How so? Well, let's look at these seven golden lampstands first. First of all, what in the world are they? Yep, you guessed it. Candelabras. That's what they are. They're candlesticks. Very similar, by the way, to what we saw in the tabernacle in the wilderness. Very similar to what Solomon put in the temple in Jerusalem. Very similar to what would have been in pretty much any Jewish religious home. It was light. So these seven lampstands, or these candlesticks, what are they? Revelation 1:20, on your own time, you can see it. They're the seven churches. Those seven things are these particular seven churches. Now, why in the world is this important? Why would he choose to use light candle imagery? Well, do you remember Jesus' first sermon? What was his first sermon? The Sermon on the Mount. Didn't Jesus have something to say about candlelight? Hiding it under a bushel? No, I'm going to let it shine. Was that Jesus? I mean, it was kind of Jesus. What did he say? Matthew 5, we'll put it on the screen for you. Matthew 5, verse 14, the scripture says, you are the light of the world. Notice the individual thing. You, Christian, you have the Spirit of God inside of you. You're the light of the world. Now notice this corporate thing then. Then, when y'all are together, what happens? You're a city set on a hill, and it cannot be hidden. You can't hide. When everybody's gathered together, all of their lights come together and shine. And then he says, you're a city that cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand. Why do they do that? Because it gives light to the whole house. The house imagery here is the world. That when you let your light shine and you connect with other believers in God's church, in the kingdom of God, you're not hiding it under a bushel and ashamed. I'm a Christian. Oh my gosh, you got to hide it. Nope. You come together and you're shining so bright that everybody in this dark world can see, oh, that's where the light is. Right there on the hill, summit off of Ooster Pike, that's where the light is. Oh, that's where the light is over on the other side of town. Oh, that's where the light is over here. Oh, that's where the light is over in Cambodia. That's where the light is in Ecuador. Oh, that's where the light is in Canada. I know that's shocking, but there is light there, I promise. Oh, that's where the light is in Mexico. That's where the light is in Ireland. That's where the light is because that's where all the individuals' lights come together and they've gathered together corporately, which is why the gathering matters, by the way, is because all of our lights come together and they shine and push back the darkness. That's what happens. And it gives light to the whole house in the same way. Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and glorify your God, your Father, who is in heaven. You see, what Jesus is going to tell them is some of those churches, their light's gone dim. Their light's gone dim. They put a bushel over the light. They forgot that they were to put it on a stand, put it on top, and shine it as bright as it can be. And their light's gone dim. And the truth is, if we're honest, maybe some of our lights today have gone a little dim too. Maybe there are some churches corporately where they need to get their light back. They need to get that brilliance back. What's interesting is a church is made up of little lights that reflect the one light, the glory of God in the world. And I think that the reason these seven are here is because maybe we need to ask ourselves as our church in these days, has our light gone dim? Is there a potential for our church's light to go dim? Or can we shine brighter? And that's what we're going to spend time talking about through this whole series is, as individuals, how do I get my glow back? And then how do we shine brighter as a church? Sounds like a fun time to me. What else? He was, notice what that says in verse 13, that he was in the midst of them. One like the Son of Man, a favorite term of Jesus to call himself, the Son of Man. It's imagery from Daniel chapter 7. You got to be careful, because I don't really think John was using Daniel I don't think John used Daniel as reference material for his writings, but did he know about Daniel? Of course he did. But he does use some familiar language from Daniel, which describes Jesus as the Ancient of Days, very familiar language of what he's using here. It's a very similar context in verse 13 to Daniel 7. And he's in the midst. Everybody say in the midst. The point necessarily isn't just the lamps have gone a little dim. The point is, look through the lamp and who do you see? Ha! Behind that, in the middle of all those churches, guess who's there? Somebody who said they would always be there. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, lo and always, I will be with you to the end of the age, to the end of all things. At the end of the last page of the book of Revelation, guess who's there? Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And we will be there with him forever. And he said, you've got nothing to fear. You can be empowered because I'm in the midst of this thing with you, holding you up, empowering you with courage. He's here right now. Do you sense him? And that's why you can feel empowered when it's dark, because you got Jesus. So you can shine as bright as you want to. Let him shine through you. He isn't absent from his church. He's right there in the midst of them, empowering them through the trials and persecution. Can you imagine what those seven churches sensed when they heard that? What? He's here now with us? It doesn't feel like it. It feels intense. It feels dark and we're hated. Oh, no, he's there. He's empowering you. Number two, he saw Jesus interceding for his church. Interceding for his church. Notice verse 13, it says that he had clothes on, praise God. And he was with a long robe and with a golden sash around his chest. Y'all, that is priestly language. The priests wore these sashes. You remember we studied that? The Levites in Exodus, when they set up the tabernacle, they had all this garb and this fancy material. And that's exactly what we're seeing here in Revelation, that you now have Jesus who is empowering his church in the midst with them, not absent, but there. And he is now doing what a priest does, interceding on their behalf, Romans 8:34, that he is sitting at the right hands of the Father, interceding for his church, praying for your strength, praying for your courage, praying for your endurance, praying for your perseverance, praying for those things so that you can last. And that's what he's doing. And that's what he saw. Imagine the confidence of a persecuted person slowly from this to go, are you kidding me right now? Come on. Come what may. If God be for us, who can be against us? Man. Interceding. Then he saw Jesus purifying his church. Notice verse 14. The hairs of his head were white. So if you're going gray, you're like Jesus. Stop fighting it. Maybe you should fight it. I don't know. The hairs of his head were white like wool. Little nugget here. Laodicea was pretty dominant in the whole wool industry. Maybe there's a little flirt there with that, a little connection to that. Maybe not. The hairs of his head were white like wool, like snow. And really, in the ancient world, there was no real good picture of pure white, and John's doing as good as he can to explain how pure this was. His eyes were like a flame of fire. Fire has a way of purifying things, doesn't it? Definitely purifies your motives if you get burnt, for sure. I got burnt by a grill like 4 weeks ago, and I still have a blister on my thumb from it. There's a purifying effect to go, don't touch hot things, dummy. His feet were like burnished bronze, refined in a furnace. So his hair. One writer says that in ancient culture, white hair was indicated both dignity and accumulated wisdom of years of experience. I mean, how experienced do you think God is? I'd say magna cum laude of experience, top of his class, wisest one ever. Amen? Yeah, and so like the picture is that his wisdom has a purifying effect on his church. Go to him. Number two, his eyes. One writer says, listen to this. This is crazy. His searching gaze penetrates the very depths of his church, revealing with piercing clarity the reality of everything that is known. Is that not Jesus? To know what I see on the outside, but get right at the heart? You're going to see this with Jesus in these seven churches. He's like, yeah, these are good. Here's what's bad. Yeah, these are good. Here's what's bad. These are good. Here's what's bad. And he cuts right to the chase. And that's what Jesus does. He can see into the depths of your motive and mine. He can see to the depths of a collective body's motive and into our minds. He can see and know all things because he's God. And his vision, knowing that, what does that do to the church? There's no doubt that purifies our leadership. It better. Otherwise, you got no business doing it. And then his feet. Not really a feet guy. Most people aren't. Feet are gross, especially in that culture. But feet, two things. Number one is a symbol of direction. Obviously, if your feet are pointed forward, where are you going? That way. Wherever your feet are pointed, it's about your vision and your direction. Who doesn't need a little bit of that about the future? Follow the feet of Jesus. He'll take you where you need to go. But most importantly, his feet are burnished bronze and fired by a furnace. When you take a precious metal and you fire it, what happens? It burns off the impurity and it fortifies it and makes it stronger. You can trust this king. You can trust him. He's been battle tested, tried and true, lived on this earth, lived the life you couldn't live, faced the persecution that you should have got, but he took it on himself and he conquered it, and you can trust him. That is amazing. I kind of want to see that. And we are right now. Now, this is weird to say it, but I just got to say it. He saw Jesus speaking. How do you see somebody speaking? Well, if they use awesome metaphor like John does, and he uses what Jesus told him to say, you see him speaking. Notice the text, it says his voice was like a roar of many waters. First, it was like a trumpet. Now, it's like waves crashing onto the shore. Everywhere John went in Patmos, by the way, at its most narrowest spot, it was 6 miles wide. He couldn't move away from whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. Every turn, he heard the voice of the roaring waters onto the beaches of Patmos. And you got to imagine the Spirit of God leading him under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit through this text, that my voice is loud and powerful like that water on the ocean, on the beach. It's a picture of Ezekiel 43:2 that pictures the voice of God with similar language, which tells us another time, in case you doubt, Jesus is God. His voice is just like God's because he is God. Which means what? You better take him at his word. What he says, you better do. You better listen. You better engage. And it says in every single instance of every single church, he who has ears, let him hear. Hear what? Hear his voice. Hear his voice. You better listen. Number five, Jesus controlling his church. Now, immediately when I say that, some of you are like, I don't really like that word controlling. You probably don't like it because you are controlling. But I don't like it either. Nobody likes to be controlled. Some of you revolted on that the last 2 years, not even crazy. I'm not going to control me. It's true. Others of you is fine, no big deal. Nobody likes to be controlled. Well, nobody likes to be controlled until Jesus is doing it. And when he controls, it's not dominance in a negative way, it's controlled with compassion and with courage. Notice what the text says. Verse 16, it says, in his right hand, everybody say right hand. In his right hand, he held 7 stars. Sweet. Aren't stars fire? They are. Symbolism, by the way. His right hand is the hand of authority and power and control. So in his hand, he holds these stars under his control, under his sanctioned power and authority in his right hand. That's where he's controlling these stars. What are these stars? Verse 20. Look at verse 20. It'll be on the screen. The stars are the angels of the 7 churches. Now, immediately, some people are like, sweet, we have guardian angels at our church? Totally. No, we don't. The Bible doesn't even teach guardian angel theology. It's not even there. What are they? As you dig through interpretation of the Bible, you look at it, really, I interpret angels as messengers, and the messengers are the pastors of that local church, of those 7 churches. So God, in his right hand, in the end, in the future, is holding these 7 churches, but every church. That pastor, that messenger, that proclaimer in his right hand of authority, controlling them. That's scary. Not scary for you, scary for me. That's a big deal. That actually should bring you great comfort, friend. Why? Because God will take us out. Oh, you're not my shepherd? Gone. You see it. Go look at evangelical pop Christian culture right now and see pastors falling and falling and falling and falling and falling. Why? Because they ceased to let God control them and they became their own God. So this should bring great comfort to you, but it's also scary for every pastor. And that's why these qualifications of pastors matter. Join me over and Paul writes it. He takes these seriously. You'll see it on the screen, but if 1 Timothy chapter 3, Paul says this to young Timothy as a young pastor. This saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to the office of overseer, that means pastor, he desires a noble task. It's not wrong to want to be a pastor and surrender your life to ministry. It's not wrong. He said, it's awesome. Go for it. But only do it if you're called. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach. Not perfect, but it means it's not going to be easy for somebody to bring a charge against them. Like, dude, they're rude. I mean, I'm rude sometimes, but I'm a human as well. But it's like a pattern of reproach over their lives. The husband of one wife, that's brought a lot of debate. Some people say pastors can't be divorced. Others say he's a one-woman man. That's how I interpret that. Sober-minded. The opposite of sober-minded is what? Drunk-minded. Like you're dumb with your thoughts. This is what it means. Like you're just inebriated in your thinking. Self-controlled in all things. That does push into sexually self-controlled. Respectable. Hospitable. If you've never had people in your home, you're doing it wrong. Able to teach. That's the only ability-driven quality in the text. Everything else is God put in. Not a drunkard. That's a crazy one. Some people say, I can drink, but it's not getting drunk. That's not what it says. Now, alcohol isn't a sin, and pastors can drink if they want. It's really up to the conviction of their own heart. But you know what that means? What it means is you live your life in such a way that you're not hopping from bar to bar, club to club, being in situations like that. You're not going to be tied to, dude, I saw that guy down at a pub last Friday. You're not tied to those types of things. You with me? Drinking's not a sin, but that it explains that there is a pattern and lifestyle of choice of inebriation. That's what it's saying. Some of you are uncomfortable. This is not for you. It's for me, just so you know. But you need to know this. Not violent, amen. Some pastors have lost their qualifications because they're domineering and violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, and not a lover of money. I just read a story of a pastor in Florida that used the PPP money to finance him and his wife's business that the church got. That guy needs to be thrown in jail and then repent of his sin publicly because he can't love money. That's what that says. He must manage his own house well. What does that mean? It means what it means, bro. If your house is a disarray, I'm not saying it needs to be cleaned. I mean, maybe it does, but you got to be able to manage your house well with all dignity, pride, good pride, dignity, keeping his children submissive. Well, some would say as long as they're in the home, they've got to be kept submissive. Wrong answer. Whole life. Whole life. You can't control your children. But if you've done your job as a parent, they're going to desire that. Mom, what do you think? Dad, what do you think? And they're going to submit to your authority the rest of their lives. For if someone does not know how to manage his old household, how will he care for God's church? We're a family. If you can't run your family, you have no business running God's family. Now, nobody says this is perfect. This is a pursuit in your life. He must not be a recent convert. Oh, my word. Imagine a new believer showing up there. We're going to preach out of Revelation. No Lamentations. No Judges. No Genesis. Oh, I was just reading. No. He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into condemnation of the devil. You know what that talks about? Is that your charisma outpaces your character. A lot of people can get up in front of a pulpit and speak, but they can hold your attention by what they say, but their character will cause them to fall later. So focus on character. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders so that he may not fall into disgrace and into a snare of the devil. That's why this is important to me. I'm under the control of the Holy Spirit and those qualifications. That's why that's important. When you filter that and you think about those things, that's why that's important. God takes that. You think it's serious who God holds in his hand? Do you think it's serious? Oh, it better be. And so we better take it seriously. Amen? All right. It's comforting to the church to know that Jesus has everything, even the leadership of his church, under the control. You do know Colossians 1:18 says that Jesus is the head of the church, so he's going to lead it the way he wants, and he can control whoever he wants, and he's controlling me. And you should desire that. So that means, if you don't like what I say, take it up with management. Number six, Jesus protecting his church. Notice verse 16, the second part, it says, from his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword. Ephesians tells us that the sword is the sword of the Spirit, which is the very word of God. In Revelation, we see that his word is a weapon to fight the lies of the enemy of God in the church and outside the church, that challenge our unity, that challenge, that bring discord, that this truth will combat heresy. It is the word of truth, 2 Timothy 2:15 tells us. Why do you think we do what we do at our church? We preach the word. Why? Because that's where the weapon is. That's where the power is won, is in the word of God. Number seven, Jesus reflecting his glory through the church. Verse 16, the last part says, and his face was like the sun, shining in full strength. Shining in full strength. Reminds me of the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus showed his glorified body. Peter's like, we're camping out, we're moving in. Reminds me of Exodus, where Moses experienced the very glory of God, and he came down from the mountain, his face shone bright like the sun. John sees Jesus in his glorified state, and it brings, notice what it said at the end, strength. When you get a vision of Jesus, it produces courage, not cowardice. Revelation tells us, guess who doesn't go to heaven? Cowards. Cowards don't go to heaven. That's bold. And so what we've got to do today is catch a vision of Jesus and keep it. And what I want to do, I'm going to shift gears a little bit, so I'm going to throw people a curveball here, but I want you to close your eyes. I'm not going to do anything else today. Nothing. We're not singing. We're not doing anything. We're going to sit. I don't want you to be distracted by anything else. You have just seen the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul says it this way, for God who said, let there be light in the darkness, he made this light shine in our hearts so that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. You have seen him. And when you see him, like John says in verse 17, you fall at his feet as though you were dead. You don't need music to do that. You have seen him. Fall under the full weight of his magnanimous, powerful, glorious presence. Let it wither your pride. Let it get you low in humility so that God can raise you up. That same right hand that holds the messengers is the same right hand that grabs John's shoulder and assures him that there is no reason to fear because I'm with you. Write them down. Tell them, John. Tell them what I showed you. And he commissioned him to service. Sit here right now and just think about Jesus. Think about what you've read. Glory of God in the face of Christ. Get a vision for Christ and hold on to it.